Alrighty, so hopefully everybody can see this. I want to welcome everybody to our PSYOP Bridge Builder session today. Very excited to be here. We're here to talk about exploring effective leadership practices through popular culture. You might have heard about today's session as being about leadership in a galaxy far, far away, because today is May 4th, and I want to wish everybody a May the 4th be with you. So I hope you can all feel the coursing power of the force inside of you as we start talking about exploring effective leadership practices in pop culture. We've got an all-star panel today, including Dr. Mike Urich, Dr. Gordon Schmidt, Dr. Adi Simha, and me. I'm Dr. Sai Islam, and I will let them introduce themselves as we go through today's session. Very excited to be here today. And we're going to talk a little bit about popular culture, the overlap between pop culture and leadership development, and also the relationship that that has with industrial organizational psychology. All right. And feel free to interact with us through the chat if you have a question or something comes up. I will be, actually all of our panelists will be monitoring the chat every now and again. And we'd love to make sure that everybody is able to interact and communicate with us. If you're watching this on recorded on the YouTube channel, then please reach out to us. We'll share contact information later on in the session. Okay, just a little agenda. We're gonna do a little welcome and intro. Dr. Mike Urich's gonna talk a little bit about the series. Then he'll talk a little bit about Star Wars, which is what we're all here for. Talk a little bit about Lord of the Rings. Then Gordon and I will talk a little bit about the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And Adi will bring things home with our very exciting wizards and wizard section about Harry Potter, which is also relevant because Doctor Strange opens up this week. And then we'll have time at the very end for a little Q&A. So without further ado, I'm just going to give everybody a chance to introduce themselves. So we'll start with Dr. Mike Urich. Why don't you give a quick rundown of who you are?
Hi, I'm Mike Urich. I wrote actually the first two books in the series of the Exploring Effective Leadership Practices through Popular Culture series that we're talking about today through Emerald. First being, it's tough to see there, Manager's Guide to Using the Force. And, I'll be talking a little bit about that today. The books are from Emerald, and the first two books came out last year. I'll talk more about this later, but Sai and Gordon and Addy all have books coming out actually in the next couple of weeks. So we're really excited about those books too. Yeah, happy to be here. Welcome. Thanks for being here. As you can see, I have my X-Wing parked right behind me.
There we go. As every good Jedi should. Okay. All right. And let's go to Dr. Gordon Schmidt.
Hi, I'm Dr. Gordon Schmidt. I am an associate professor of organizational leadership at Purdue Fort Wayne. Study all kinds of different leadership stuff, with virtual leadership being a main area. I have my PhD in organizational psychology from Michigan State. And so Sai and I have a book coming out soon related to Marvel Cinematic Universe and leadership. And we are currently writing another book in this series looking at Avatar: The Last Airbender and leadership, which will be a lot of fun to write, and I'm sure a lot of fun to read as well.
And last but certainly not least is Dr. Adi Simha.
Hello, everyone. My name is Adi Simha. I'm an associate professor of management at the University of Wisconsin-Whitewater. And as Mike has mentioned, I'm writing the book on Harry Potter and leadership. And that should be out later this month, May 30th, actually. I was just thinking, if we had done this 2 days earlier, we would have hit the International Harry Potter Day. So we're just 2 days later than we could be. So yeah, I look forward to interacting with you all.
No, I was not aware of that. We should plan some stuff for next year for that date.
Yeah, that'd be a good idea.
Sai, did you introduce yourself yet?
I'm about to.
Oh, okay.
I always try to avoid these introductions. So my name is Dr. Sai Islam. I'm an associate professor of industrial organizational psychology at Farmingdale State College. I'm also vice president of consulting with Talent Metrics Consulting. And I did my PhD in applied organizational psychology from Hofstra University. I did my master's and my MBA from Fairleigh Dickinson University. And someone very special to me is here today, Dr. Diane Wentworth, who was my master's thesis advisor at Fairleigh Dickinson University and in many ways changed my life. So very excited to have her here tonight. and I can't wait to talk a little bit about pop culture. So with that, I'm going to hand things over to Dr. Urich, who's going to kick things off.
All right. I'm going to focus today on my book, A Manager's Guide to Using the Force. But before I do that, Dr. Islam did ask if I'd give a little bit of a background on the book series itself. It's really so much fun. And anyone that's interested in popular culture, I think, would really enjoy this series. Of course, you know, Cy and Gordon are working on, your book on the MCU is coming out in a couple of weeks. The Avatar book is coming out probably in a year or two, I think, after that. Addie's book is coming out in a couple of weeks on Harry Potter. But we also have books in development on Game of Thrones and a couple of other areas of pop culture that we're about ready to announce anytime. I'm editor of the series, and working on the series is really a dream, in addition to writing the first two books. And I didn't expect it to happen. It actually occurred... November 2019, Emerald had approached me about writing a book on generational issues in the workplace, which is sort of my bread and butter. I do a lot of research in that area. But I had just written a book on that, and I thought, you know, I'm a little bit burned out from that. So whenever I was talking with Emerald, Fiona Allison, who's the best editor ever from Emerald, I said, you know, I have two other ideas, too, that I want to share with you. And one is a book about leadership in Star Wars, and another is a book about leadership and Middle Earth, or Lord of the Rings. And I thought I was going to get laughed off the call. I thought she was just going to laugh at me and say, okay, never mind. But instead, she said, I love it. This is great. To me, this sounds like a series. And so that's sort of where the series came from. And from there, we've been building, relationships with other authors. That's how I met Gordon and Cy and Addie. And we have a lot of great books coming out. So if you're interested in anything related to pop culture or leadership, pick up a copy of one of the books. And if you have an idea for future books, please email me. I'll put my contact information in the chat in a couple of seconds. And of course, we'd invite you to submit a proposal or suggest a topic to one of us if you'd like to see one of us develop it. But we're always looking for new authors. So today I'm going to focus on A Manager's Guide to Using the Force, Leadership Lessons from a Galaxy Far, Far Away. That's the first book in this series that came out actually just a little bit over a year ago. So that gives you a little bit of a sense for what the book's about. You know, I love watching movies and TV shows and thinking about how IO concepts or behavior concepts or leadership concepts are illustrated in pop culture. One of my favorite areas is, of course, leadership. One of my favorite areas of study, one of my favorite areas of pop culture is, of course, Star Wars. And, just even thinking of the classic line from Star Wars, who's the more foolish, the fool or the fool who follows him? Classic line spoken by Obi-Wan Kenobi in the original film from 1977. You know, you get a sense that leadership is an important topic in the Star Wars universe, in the Star Wars galaxy. This other quote here, great leaders inspire greatness in others. That's actually from the cartoon, The Clone Wars. Actually, I think that was the opening quote in probably one of the first, if not the first episode in the series. The approach of the series, and the approach of using Star Wars to talk about leadership, is that pop culture is a useful tool. We can learn from anything, you know, whether it's the MCU, Star Wars, the Wizarding World, we can learn from anything. And as I watch the Star Wars films, the Jedi to me are really a particularly interesting example, because they have certain values that they use to exert their influence. They use certain values in how they make decisions. And all of that relates to how they perform as a team or how they exert, influence on the galaxy overall. So there are a lot of successful aspects of leadership that a Jedi approach could be used towards. And so some of the things we're going to discuss today, very briefly, are the things that are outlined in the book. In the book, I tend to use leadership and management somewhat interchangeably. It's not quite the same, really, in theory, obviously. But, you know, Jedi manager just has a nice ring to it. Although the theories in the book are oftentimes about leadership theories and some other things related to leadership. So what's the book cover? What are some things that are characteristic of a Jedi manager or a Jedi leader? And that's a picture of me, actually, wearing my Jedi hat about a year ago, the day that I received my copy of the book when it first came out. Well, one thing that the Jedi do is they develop others and they continuously develop themselves as well. You know, if you think about the model of a Jedi master and a Padawan, oftentimes we're looking at two individuals who serve as both a mentor and a mentee. Okay, and there's a lot of classic mentorship relationships in Star Wars. Of course, Anakin and Obi-Wan, Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon, Rey and Luke, Luke and Obi-Wan, Luke and Yoda. And so we see this mentorship relationship occur over and over and over again. But if you think about it, that's one of the key things that leaders do, is they mentor and they teach others. Now, the interesting thing, I think, about these mentorship relationships is that in many instances, it's not just the mentor developing the mentee. It's really mutual mentorship that goes both ways. I think of the example from the sequel trilogy of Rey and Luke's mentoring relationship. It's not just Luke teaching Rey. Rey teaches Luke a lot about the galaxy as well and a lot about himself. And so Jedi managers don't just pass on what they know to others. They also continue to train. They continue to develop themselves to become the best managers that they can be as well. They also serve a team. Now, a lot of what the Jedi do is related to service. So, yeah, they're working in pairs a lot, that mentor-mentee pair, the Padawan-master pair, but they're also working a lot in teams too. You know, Luke's part of a team that helps bring down the second Death Star. Rey is part of a team that helps attack Emperor Palpatine whenever he's mysteriously resurrected in the final of the sequel films. And so there's a team, and the Jedi use their skills to work towards a team. They also remain focused. One of the things about the Jedi way is they have to be mindful of what they're doing. It's one of the Yoda's classic quotes. Always be mindful. Keep your mind on what you're doing here and now. So much so that if we're not mindful, if we exert our energy too many places at once, it can be detrimental to us. And so that's one thing that actually Luke does in The Last Jedi. Luke basically tries to be in two places at once, if you think about it. He's not focused on himself, on being mindful. He's not focused on where he's at. And in doing so, he expends too much energy that he ceases to exist in the galaxy, in the universe. Jedi also make self-sacrifices for the common good. So a Jedi's mind is not meant to be focused on what they want. If you think about the Jedi code, they're supposed to be emotionless, which has some problems in and of itself, of course. But this idea of being emotionless, or at least not having extreme emotions, means that we're trying to serve others for a common purpose as well. A Jedi is skilled, of course. Not only are they trained with the lightsaber, but they're skilled in a variety of other areas as well. They're duty-minded and they're virtuous. So in other words, they're values-laden. The book talks a lot about the particular values and duties that a Jedi has and engages in. They also influence others in a positive manner. Now, this taken with the next one, communicating with confidence, these are two things that I find really important. One of what a Jedi does, one thing that a Jedi does is to communicate well. You know, it's kind of controversial, I think, some of the things that Obi-Wan told Luke. You know, Obi-Wan was a little bit bending the truth with regard to who Darth Vader was. Obi-Wan really wasn't forthcoming about who Leia was to Luke. But the way that he communicated to Luke was in a way that motivated Luke to do something. Now, I think we can argue whether he was ethical or unethical, or whether he lied or bended the truth in some of the statements that he made. But the point is that he communicated in a way that would resonate with Luke, that would then make him leave Tatooine to help save the galaxy. Similarly, a Jedi oftentimes speaks with confidence. And you can see that with the classic Jedi mind trick, of course. Now, that's not all there is to communicating with confidence and just saying these aren't the droids you're looking for. But there is something to say about speaking with confidence in a way that could resonate with an audience. It's important for a leader or a manager to understand. A Jedi also respects the differences of others. If you think about the Jedi Council, there's a lot of different ideas. There's a lot of galactic diversity in the Jedi Council. So they have to work together. They're finding out about the best way to approach problems because we respect the differences of others as a Jedi manager. They're also adaptable yet resilient in the face of crisis situations. No one expected Emperor Palpatine to come back in The Rise of Skywalker. In fact, Poe in the story says, we don't even know how this happened, or alludes to that. Well, you know, I was on another call today talking about the same topic. And it was a reading group about the book, and they were talking about how while I was writing the book, I had to insert COVID. They were surprised that COVID came up in the book because it came out during the pandemic. And I said, you know, I was watching Rise of Skywalker, and as silly as that line that Poe says sounds, somehow Palpatine's back. Well, sometimes unexpected things happen to us, and we have to account for that. So yeah, Palpatine came back. The Resistance had to respond to that. COVID pops up. Our organizations have to respond to that. Us as leaders have to respond to that. And so we have to understand how to be resilient in the face of crisis and how to adapt to crisis. We also have to learn from failure. One of the teachings that Yoda said is that the greatest teacher failure is. So we have to learn from failure and how to do better next time. And of course, we have to resist the lure of the dark side. The dark side, we can get some quick wins. You know, transactional leadership is the approach that Darth Vader often takes. If you don't do what he says, he's going to force choke you. That's kind of transactional nature. And yes, he has the fear of his followers in him, but it's not sustainable. So we want to resist the lure of the dark side, because as soon as that leader's gone, those followers aren't necessarily engaging in top performance, or they're not necessarily motivated. Think about how the aim of stormtroopers is so bad when Darth Vader's not in the room, because they're not motivated to perform when he's not there instilling fear in them. And so we want to resist the lure of the dark side and think more in a servant mindset and a transformational mindset in many situations, as that would be, I think, perhaps a better approach to leading. Here's some contact information. Feel free to give me a call on my cell. Here's my email address, also my webpage, and I'm happy to connect with any of you. I'll leave this up here for a couple of seconds before transitioning over to Gordon and Cy. Take it away, guys.
All right, thank you so much, Mike. Very excited to hear all about that with regards to Star Wars. Why don't we talk a little bit, we'll switch gears a little bit, and we'll talk a little bit now about leadership in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And luckily, both owned by Disney, so we're still part of the same conglomerate, which is important. And I wanted to mention that there's a lot of good conversation happening in the chat, led by our very own Dr. Gordon Schmidt and Addy Simma. All right. So just some personal introductions. This is really just an excuse to show our nerd bona fides here. So we mentioned earlier that I'm associate professor at Farmingdale State College and also vice president of consulting at Talent Metrics Consulting. But I also own lots and lots of nerd t-shirts. So as you can see, I've got a Captain America, Deadpool. I will gladly hold your baby while wearing my Playboy philanthropist billionaire shirt. And of course, my wife and I went to see Black Panther. So, you know, once you are known as a nerd, people just start sending you t-shirts and other accoutrements that is related to Marvel. And as you can see, our cutest fan is Gordon's son, Dimitri. I don't know if you wanted to add anything there, Gordon.
No, we'll get into it more. I'm just an associate professor of organizational leadership at Purdue Fort Wayne. And Cy and I were just very excited to write this book, and we'll talk more about, you know, some of what we see about the Marvel Cinematic Universe and all that in a moment here. So,
all right, very good. So let's talk a little bit about why. So I'll hand things off to Gordon. So why do we even do this?
Yeah, so talking about that now. So why the Marvel Cinematic Universe? And I changed my background from Star Wars related, which is relevant for the day, to book related with the movies. You got to be on brand, right? That's crucial. But so why the Marvel Cinematic Universe? Well, I would say, you know, firstly, Cy and I really grew up with Marvel comic books. We both read them in the comics. We've always been big fans there. And so when the Marvel Cinematic Universe came out, you know, it was a very big thing for us. I think the original X-Men movies, the original Spider-Man movies, they were good. They really got the ball rolling. But this shared universe of the Marvel Cinematic Universe just was a step forward and something that really made this an institution versus just a few stray good movies where the third movie tends to be pretty bad. Sorry, Cy, I know you like Spider-Man 3, but generally the third movie is the worst one in those, and then they kind of stop. And so one thing that for us too is, you know, IO psychologists, is we've always watched these movies and thought about there's a lot of leadership going on. There's a lot of concepts related to motivation and working together and all of these topics that we care about. And these are professional organizations to some degree, right? The Avengers are not just some buddies that hang out. Some of them seem to actually, you know, actively dislike each other, but they have a job to do. And so this has always been something of interest to us. I know we on my campus, we did a movie night with Avengers when it came out, and we talked about the movie and all these leadership concepts. We've used these things in our classroom significantly. And so when we saw this call out there in the world by Mike about this series, we said, man, Marvel Cinematic Universe would be great for that. It would also give me an excuse to subscribe to Disney Plus. So I was like, all right, I'm going to watch all these movies. We're going to have a good time. We're going to connect it to this IO psychology nerdiness that I like with these movies that we like as well. And so that's kind of the big picture of it, is we already saw and we thought about this, but the book made us really go into a lot more depth of thinking about it and really coming up with, I think, a lot of cool examples and ways to do that. And Cy and I also do quite a bit of research looking at outreach related to industrial organizational psychology anyways. And so to us, this is kind of part of that mission too. And certainly Bridge Builders as a group and their goals very much fit with that. How do we get our ideas out there? And these approachable pop culture things are such a great way for people to understand what's going on. You mentioned leader member exchange to somebody and they'll be like, what are you talking about? But if you talk about it within characters in a movie, the relationship between, you know, Captain America and members of the Avengers, suddenly it makes a lot more sense. And so that's a very appealing concept to us. And it really drove that book, that question of outreach. I definitely recommend Mike's books a lot, the Middle Earth book and the Jedi book. Man, I just read them like multiple times, you know, as we were doing it. It's like, I love this structure. This book's a lot of fun. And so it just really was a very engaging way and very clear. And that's something Cy and I are focused on as well. Can we have things be clear and understandable? Because as we know, that's not always the case in you know, our academic journals necessarily. That's not always the case sometimes in what we do. So we really were like, how can we make this understandable? So I think that gives a good intro to that. Cy, was there anything you wanted to throw in related to kind of our our purpose.
just one more thing. This was a great excuse to watch the movies again and then to be able to tell our spouses this was work. So great way for us to have our cake and eat it too in this situation. So I've got a question for the audience here. So we've got a great audience now. And what I'd like to see is in the chat, since we've been talking a little bit about the children and getting them involved in learning a little bit about our field using pop culture, I'd just like to know, what is your favorite Marvel character? Who is your favorite? And if you have a favorite, do you think they're a good leader? Because that's really one of the things that we want to kind of talk about. One of the big challenges of kind of illustrating ideas in leadership, especially, is that people kind of know what leadership looks like. People can identify it, but oftentimes, whether it's in academic classroom or whether it's in consulting situation or coaching situation, you know that it's hard to get people to kind of wrap their heads around a particular concept. So Mike gave an example in the chat about Tuchman's leadership model. Tuchman's leadership model, very close to my heart, but not everybody always knows and understands what that model looks like. So let's see. So Sarah says, I always gravitate toward favorite characters that are good leaders, but there's such good examples of bad leaders in pop culture. So I'm open to seeing bad leaders as well. If you think somebody's a bad leader. So Brian mentions Wanda Maximoff. Marvel hasn't portrayed her in a leadership role, but I can see her being a reliable leader. I can see her being a very forceful leader, which is kind of hinted at in the trailers for Doctor Strange. No spoilers just yet for anything that I've seen. Gordon mentions my son smiled when the dark side of the force was mentioned in New Hope, so I need to be watching him. Yeah, maybe his name should be Anakin. I don't know. So Adi says Gore the God Butcher. Oh boy, we're going into the future of those characters. Wow. All right, very, very interesting. Not a great leader, right? Very destructive. Okay. And let's see. So daughter's favorite character is Emperor Palpatine. Mike, I don't know. You got to watch your back, man. I don't know. So I'll say that my favorite character out of the Marvel Cinematic Universe is probably Black Panther. And I think he's a pretty good leader. And I think actually the cast of Black Panther is stacked with several good leaders. So there's T'Challa, who's a Black Panther, who genuinely listens to other people. He genuinely like takes in what other people are saying, even his enemies. So there's a big movement in the kind of Twitter community and social media community to say that Killmonger was right about a lot of things, right? He's the big enemy in Black Panther, and he was, right? Historically speaking, he's correct. His methods, not very good, but overall, his core idea of kind of changing the world is correct. A good leader like T'Challa is able to kind of take that idea and say, hey, I'm gonna run with it, and I'm going to make things happen in this regard. Second great leader from Wakanda is General Okoye. She is able to lead a group of the Dora Milaje, who are the female bodyguards of the Black Panther. And when the world of Wakanda is in trouble, she is that stabilizing force. She is that force. And luckily in Wakanda, we don't seem to have those gender issues around leadership. People seem to respect her as both a warrior and as a peacetime leader, and she has that capability. Third leader in Black Panther is Nakia, who shows leadership not by having a real role that's leadership, she's a spy, but she's able to exert her influence to be convincing, to be passionate, and that's a lot of what we talk about with leadership. Gordon mentioned that earlier, that's our conception of leadership. Leadership is an influence process. It's not about the title that you have, it's really about your ability to communicate and to have some sort of influence. And our last, kind of great leader in the Black Panther universe is Shuri. She's a leader in terms of her technical knowledge, because everybody knows that she has a lot of scientific know-how. But then at the very end, she starts to do some outreach. And there is a chapter where we talk about external relations. All right. I'm going to hand things off to Gordon to talk a little bit about the topics that we cover in the book.
Yeah, great. So we've got a whole variety of topics, as you can see on the screen here. One thing I want to focus on, too, is the fact that we can learn even if the leaders make mistakes, right, in these movies. And so when, we've got a great chapter on conflict management looking at Captain America Civil War, where we certainly argue in the book that this is a failure of the Avengers to really use conflict management skills to really think about the conflicts they have. And so you've got this conflict between Captain America and Iron Man related to who should make the decisions related to the Avengers. Iron Man saying that it should be delegated to this United Nations group, while Captain America says we should make the choices here. It should be our own moral judgment. Both sides have some reasonable points, but there also is a lot of potential room for compromise, for collaboration that don't get taken. Both are kind of like, it's my way or the highway, and that kind of leads the Avengers to essentially fracture. And one could argue that some of the issues that come out in the MCU might have been lessened or maybe even solved if the Avengers had just talked it through a little bit, had done conflict management techniques, had tried to keep their conflict related to process and figuring out the right course of action versus it getting more personal, because Cap and Iron Man make it a lot more personal. And I think that that's one thing I think is nice with the book too, is this is a real conflict. We can say these leaders were wrong. Well, in a lot of our own work context, to say my boss is wrong is not something that's going to work and is not something that's going to be accepted, right? But to say Iron Man screwed up in this way or Captain America screwed up in this way, it's a lot easier, less confrontational. But we can also say, oh, this is also something like what we've experienced. We need to watch for these problems. So that's one example.
All right, great. So one other topic that I want to talk about, I mentioned this in the chat, but Captain America is a great example of a servant leader. And one of the challenges in talking about servant leadership is that our conception of a leader is usually somebody who's much more forceful, who's much more, kind of out there, a little bit more like Tony Stark. But Captain America is a wonderful example of servant leadership because he has a lot of the character traits of a servant leader. He's very humble, and sometimes being humble is seen as uncool, which it can be kind of difficult for leaders. Leaders want to be seen as somebody that should be followed. But Captain America shows how you can be humble and still be a leader. He's really authentic. He's always himself. He's about empowering people, which is a really interesting take given the era that he's from. He's part of the Greatest Generation. He's really able to kind of give authority over to people. You see that in the first movie where he's able to give, Peggy Carter, his love interest, his power and this respect that allows her to flourish. He's able to accept her on an interpersonal level while still being able to provide direction. And he really cares about who people are. He serves as a steward, as a protector for them to create space so that they can accomplish what they need to accomplish. And so it's really hard in many cases to describe why somebody's a great leader when they're a servant leader. And I think Captain America really does a great job of that. And we talk a little bit about that in the book. All right. With that in mind, I'm going to hand things off to Gordon to talk a little bit about how you can use our book in an academic setting.
Yeah. So there's a lot of different ways that this can be used. and in our first chapter, we talk about this a bit, is that this is something where people, we could watch the film, whether people watch it on their own or elsewise, and then talk about the topics. It's something where you could have different groups or different teams watch different films and then draw lessons from them. There's a lot of different ways you can do that. And I think in terms of both undergrad and graduate related areas, this is a type of thing that could be a grad school seminar looking at leadership directly through these types of films. I think, as we've said, we're not saying, oh, go out and be a Marvel leader exactly like they do. Even for people that we think do things well, there's also drawbacks in what they do. And I think that there's the question of development. So someone like Tony Stark, Iron Man, he never gets to perfect. He still annoys people. he's arrogant, But I think he grows a lot during the movies and he becomes more of his authentic self and an authentic leader. And so it certainly helps us to kind of get beyond some of those myths related to these perfect people or perfect leaders that are always correct. And of course, that bias related to leaders just know the right answer and they do it and they never do anything wrong, right? And so that's some of the stuff we can see in educational settings. Certainly clips from the movies can be very useful as well. And the book does have chapters that connect to a number of existing leadership related textbooks as well. So if you were like, oh, we're really going to focus on conflict management, or we're going to focus on servant leadership, there's a chapter for that in a movie or a selection of clips that could be watched to get at that through the actual film. So, Sai, anything you want to add to?
Just that I'm trying to be cool in the classroom in some way, and we're trying to be relatable, and I think the book lends itself to that. All right, thank you. And so let's talk a little bit about how we can use this in an applied setting. So one of the things that I do in my work is, as a consultant, I do some executive coaching. For those who don't know, executive coaching is defined as coach working one-on-one with executives to help them learn how to manage and lead, and to assist them to establish structure, plan for the and lead the executive's organization. So this is a classic definition from Stern 2004. It kind of covers everything that you're going to need when you talk about executive coaching. We know from some research from Callahan et al. That they have used pop culture to kind of communicate ideas in executive coaching, but I want to make this a little bit more realistic for everyone. When you're working with a leader in an executive coaching session, that leader, somebody who in their work environment, doesn't have the ability to be vulnerable, they need to be vulnerable with you as an executive coach, as a leadership coach. So you have to create a space where they can actually be open, where they can be vulnerable with you. And one way we can do that is by moving away from the specifics of their situation. So if you can imagine dealing with a friend where they're going through a very difficult topic, they're having a tough time, and they're just getting caught up in the specifics of that situation. Oh, I'm having trouble with my girlfriend. Here's all the problems that she's bringing to me. Here's all the things that I'm trying to do. And you just know that if you can pull them back, if you can give them that kind of bird's eye view, they'll be able to see things a little bit more clearly. In executive coaching, we see the same thing. Leaders start to talk about, well, this employee gives me all these problems. This person doesn't listen. This person doesn't have technical knowledge. And so one way that I use pop culture is to kind of bring them out of that situation where we're talking about their very highly charged, challenging job. And we try to bring it down a notch and say, okay, let's bring it down a little bit and let's talk about movies. And sometimes leaders are a little resistant to that. They're like, well, I thought this was going to be serious. Thought we were here to talk about serious leader stuff. And I have to tell them, well, let's talk about this. Let's talk about something in pop culture that we can both connect to, and let's see what lessons we can derive. One way to talk to them about this is to illustrate this idea that we learn things through storytelling. There's a lot of research that indicates that humans provide meaning and understand meaning through them. And so once you're able to pull that leader away from the specifics of that situation, and you allow them to kind of think through a problem in a simulated world, it helps them understand their own situation. In the same way, when you watch a movie or a TV show, you can reflect on your own life. You can say, wow, I'm really a Phoebe right now. I can't believe it, right? So that's something that we try to do, and it's been a great help in many of my executive coaching situations. With regards to classroom training, we know that managers, they build leadership through storytelling. And one very common way of developing leaders is really through book clubs. There's a nice little body of research about using book clubs in leadership development. And one thing that we're trying to do in this book series is we want to pull people away a little bit from the airport books that they might traditionally use. And they might traditionally say, hey, we should, I found this while I was on layover at Newark International Airport. We'd like them to use our books because they're a little bit more based around science. Another way to use these books is through supplemental reading. We know that for top executives, the ability to read is one of the key skills that they actually have. So Sarah mentioned executive coaching is a possible career path in IO, a site that many people pursue as they get a little bit of experience. It gives you a lot of freedom to pursue owning your own consulting business and making a big impact on real leaders. This is very true. I want to say that there's been an explosion in coaching work, especially through different platforms. Very, very important. Thank you, Mike, for agreeing with that. And Brian says, I had no idea about executive coaching. I think it was completely different from IO. It's not different than IO. There's a lot of IO psychologists that actually do it. And Sarah mentioned, yes, I meant to say owning your own consulting business. Sorry, for having no problem. And we know IOs have a huge impact. Lots of IOs work in coaching, and it's a great way to really make a huge impact on organizations. So with that, I hand things off to Gordon.
Yeah, I'll just mention briefly here this idea of leadership development. I think the leadership coaching part fits very well. And so I think Sai has covered a number of these aspects here, but pop culture, is that another way to understand leadership, to come up with examples and to kind of see it in action? We see it very clearly in the movies with Spider-Man. Within the MCU, one of the things I think the MCU adds that's very rich is his relationship with Tony Stark and this idea of somebody else who has some overlap in various ways in terms of science, in terms of being a superhero, that's somebody that I can look up to, that I can get advice from and develop that relationship. And so I think these examples in the films give a lot of help. I think leadership development, it's often important to have that support to be successful, and why it really matters. I alluded to a little bit in the chat earlier as well, but I think there are questions in the movie. We're gonna look at somebody like Black Widow. Black Widow is a character that to some degree, as we were reading the book, we thought about a lot more. And she basically seems to be sort of the leader of the Avengers and de facto kind of the world of superheroes during the 5-year gap period. You know, some people phase out, some people quit. So Thor, you know, gets burned out and leaves. Captain America is sort of helping people with grief, but isn't leading. You know, Iron Man goes off to live his own life. The Hulk goes off to reintegrate himself. And so Black Widow becomes the one who's in charge without much experience on the team to do that. And I think it'd be really interesting for us to see more of what she does during that time period, because the world seems to be in kind of a good place 5 years later, considering losing half the population of the world, right? It seems like things are functioning. People are sad, as they would be, but the idea that the world would be in really bad straits would make some sense, but they've made something that works. And we talk about this in our book about female leadership as well, is that I do think Black Widow ends up being a bit of an example of this idea of what's called the glass cliff. So if you're not familiar with it, certainly it builds on that idea of the glass ceiling. So women can't get above a certain level. There's things that keep women from moving to top positions. The glass cliff is this other idea that's as insidious and problematic, which is we make women the leaders after a big scandal or when there's a big chance for failure. And so Black Widow is put in possibly one of the, you know, most risky type situations, right? The world has had its biggest tragedy ever. You know, all of the other leaders are leaving and suddenly they say, Black Widow, take care of this. I think she does an excellent job. I'd love to see more of what she actually does. And I think honestly, watching the movie again, it's a little heartbreaking to me is that once Scott Lang shows up and says, hey, I got an idea to bring everybody back, all the white dudes come back and say, hey, we're the leader now again, right? Cap comes back, Iron Man comes back, and Black Widow goes back to being just a member of the team. I think she probably has a lot more to add after 5 years in the biggest crisis situation around, right? That probably would be helpful. And it's, I think that that's an interesting element as we were really looking at the movie, that I don't think she gets the credit she's due. We don't see the work she does, similar to how we often don't see the good work some leaders are doing. People can take a lot of credit and not have a lot of impact. I think she had a lot of impact. We don't see a lot of it. And I think it's a disservice that the MCU does to her a bit with that. So that leadership development, those opportunities to develop and improve and grow are crucial.
We don't even get a movie with her until after she's done. So
yeah, and it's in the past. It's not during when she has her biggest impact, right? Yep. So yeah, it's interesting.
All righty. So just wanted to share some quick references in case anybody wants to read some of the research articles that we've referenced so far. And then if you would like to get in touch with us, please feel free to do so. If you have any questions, send us an email. And with that, I'm going to hand things over to Addie and finish things out with Harry Potter.
All right, so, okay, I'm at the thank you page. I should go back. All right, so this is kind of tough. I'm having to follow two awesome sessions. So I'm kind of like the main event guy, but it's like, yeah, anyway, I'll try to do my best. So I'll be talking about my book, which, you know, this title that you see on here, that was the original title. So we had to shorten it. So poor muggles and poor squibs, they got discarded from the title, but I included them here just, you know, for those of us that are not magically gifted, this book is useful for you as well, because you can still pick up something about leadership from it. It's not just for wizards and witches, you know, muggles and squibs also can benefit. Let's see. All right, so I'll introduce myself a bit more in detail, I guess. Like I mentioned earlier, I am an associate professor of management at the University of Wisconsin, Whitewater. And my research areas are in business ethics, organizational behavior, and leadership. And I've been teaching leadership for almost a dozen years by now, I think. Almost 12 years. And in my classes, I've used a variety of Harry Potter references, which is why I'll get to the next slide in a bit. So so that's me with my family, my wife, my two kids, our dog. She is not a boar hound like Hagrid's dog, but she is a hound. She is an otter hound. So, you know, similar family. The picture down there, you know, that's the only, unfortunately, that's the closest thing I have to a Harry Potter robe. But, you know, I like it. I at the time when I bought it, when I was graduating, I think I had like $300 in my bank account. And this thing was worth $650. So I had to, like, you know, put it on my credit card. But so this is probably the most expensive outfit I have in my, you know, in my wardrobe. So I make sure I always wear it. Every commencement, I wear it and I proudly go out there. So, and the cover over there, I just wanted to put that on there to give you guys an idea of how the book looks like, because I don't have the physical copy yet. It's, it'll be out May 30th. All right. So I'll talk a little bit about why I chose Harry Potter and the Wizarding World to explain leadership. So like I mentioned, I've been teaching leadership for, you know, quite a while now. I've taught different courses. I've taught leadership development. I've taught leadership in management. I've taught leadership in creativity. I've taught organizational leadership, a variety of courses. The one thing I always do in all of these courses is, no matter what the concept is, I always try to explain it using a context that is easily understandable. So like Gordon, Sai, and Mike have talked about, it makes it easy to relate something that is complex when you can break it down into something that people can follow. So, for example, if I wanted to talk about transformational leadership, all the, you know, different stages, it's a lot easier to talk about, like, let me use the Harry Potter context. You can talk about how, you know, certain characters in Harry Potter, they inspire others. You can talk about how certain characters have a lot of charisma. You can talk about how some folks in, you know, in the series, they have no integrity. So there's like a bunch. You have good and bad and, you know, moderate. You have all kinds, all flavors. So that's why Harry Potter is something that I think is easily understandable. It's very similar to the MCU context, to Star Wars and to LOTR and, you know, all the other books that are coming out. So when Mike put out the call for book proposals and I saw it, I was super excited. I mean, that was the opportunity I was waiting for. You know, it was almost like getting a letter by owl, you know, but I wasn't in the closet, of course, but still it felt great. So I got in touch with Mike and like you mentioned, Fiona is the most awesome book agent, I guess. So so that's why I chose Harry Potter. And I'm a huge fan of Harry Potter. I kind of, you know, grew up a bit, I guess, reading Harry Potter. And I've read every single book in the series multiple times. I have watched every single movie multiple times. And I guess I can share this now. Back when I was a teenager, I actually even wrote like a fan fiction. You know, I combined Harry Potter with Austin Powers and it was kind of cool, I thought, but unfortunately nobody came knocking from Hollywood. So the Austin Powers 4 script, you know, maybe in an alternate universe, somebody's made that movie, but here we're still waiting for that opportunity. So, one thing I wanted to mention, the images that I've used in this particular PowerPoint, the reason I use them is because to me, this is exactly what I was imagining every time I would read the book. So these are images that I think the illustrator of the book series used. So you can buy them as postcards. And I think they're really cool. So you have a link online, you can find it. So let me go to the next slide. So I should open the chat screen, a bunch of. Okay, so I wanted to like canvas your view. Which Harry Potter character do you personally identify with and like the most? Sometimes you can like a character but not really identify with it. So let's see. Ron, yeah, Ron is an awesome character. I thought he showed some, you know, dips, but overall his growth trajectory was really good, like in terms of leadership development. Hermione, yeah, absolutely. Hermione is actually my favorite character from the entire series. If I had to pick one person that I would pick as being the best in terms of leadership strength, I would pick Hermione. Because to me, she is almost the perfect leader, if you think about it. You know, like, I mean, yeah, once in a while she did lose her emotional tranquility, but for the most part, Slughorn. So Mike, Slughorn is your favorite character? Did you identify with him or do you like him? You don't identify with him.
I just like him. I don't think I identify with him. I just like him.
Yeah, so Slughorn is really interesting too, because to me, Slughorn is the person that, you know, like if I have to talk about politics, Slughorn is the guy. He knows, you know, Slub, what was he doing? He was getting together people that he could network with, people that had connections. That's kind of like Slughorn. I mean, if he were here in reality, he would be big on LinkedIn. He'd be sending requests to everybody and, you know, like he'd have a huge following. Art politics, absolutely. And yeah, great point, Mike. He was there to defend Hogwarts towards the end, you know, the final battle, which happened on May 2nd. Okay, let me just scroll up. All right. I also want to talk about this. So which Harry Potter character do you dislike or despise the most? Umbridge, of course. Umbridge is a person that, you know, those of us that are maybe, you know, those of us that don't have the luck of Domino from the MCU, just to throw in an MCU person, we've probably encountered someone like Umbridge, someone who is petty, someone who, you know, takes on power and is and uses it, misuses it to a large extent. So, you know, in the book, you'll find that I have written about Umbridge quite a fair bit. So, I mean, every time there's a bad example, Umbridge somehow squeezes in, because personally, I think Umbridge was worse than Voldemort. Because, I mean, Voldemort is, I mean, he's a, you know, he's a, what do you call it, like an evil wizard, right? But Umbridge is, she's not even gifted like Voldemort was, but she's still eviler than Voldemort was. So, great, interesting. That's an interesting choice, Dudley. I thought Dudley actually redeemed himself in my eyes, you know, towards the end. In the Dursley family, Aunt Petunia and that uncle, they were horrible people from the beginning till the end. But Dudley actually, I thought he improved a lot. I was actually hoping that, you know, Harry and Dudley would become friends towards the end of it. But I guess the drama was too much to, you know, go past. Draco is interesting too. Any other Dursleys? Yeah. Draco is an interesting choice too, because, from the beginning, he is introduced sort of like a, you know, like an antagonist. So you can see his negative side. Although, you know, he sort of redeemed himself a little bit in my eyes when he, you know, he pretended like he couldn't recognize Harry when Bellatrix had them in the, you know, in the, yeah, great point, Gordon. The bad model part, you can actually see a parallel in that with leadership, because when people do unethical things, a lot of times they model it after their leader. So if your leader is doing unethical behavior, you oftentimes end up following your leader. Unethical pro-organizational behavior, for instance, it's your leader does it, you'll do it. So yeah, great point. All right, I want to talk about this one. So I don't know if you've ever been on Pottermore, but if you haven't, you should totally check it out. Go there, take that quiz, and it'll sort you into a Hogwarts house. So if you haven't done that, which Hogwarts house do you think you would be sorted into if you, you know, if you were lucky enough to attend Hogwarts? Hufflepuff, Ravenclaw. Yeah, I actually did that like a few days back, and I was Ravenclaw. So it looks like Sai and I would be in the same house. And Gordon and Brian would be in Hufflepuff. So the cool thing about Slytherin, yeah, that's actually a fair point. I think, yes, that's probably the perception across campus. And you often see that during faculty senate meetings, which, you know, which kind of like how I imagine they are in the wizarding world, you know, so pretty much similar to that. So the Hogwarts houses, you know, one of the cool things about that is that a lot of times they're identifying people based on personality, based on value systems. You know, look at the hat, you put the hat on, the hat sort of the hat sort of tells you which house you would be best fitting for. So it's almost like a person organization fit or a person job fit, PJPO fit. It's kind of like that. So I have a section in the book on personality, but the thing is that the sorting hat, it's not necessarily accurate all the time, which is the same thing with personality. Like, it's not always apparent that your personality is going to dictate how you lead. Some people could be highly introverted and they could still be very effective leaders. Some people could be extremely low on the openness side of things, but they could still be effective in certain situations, which, you know, which don't require openness, I guess. So personality is like, I have a chapter on personality, and I really enjoyed writing that particular chapter. I enjoyed writing the book, but that is my favorite chapter, the personality one. It's the second chapter in the book. Old Hermit Islam, is that from Old Man Logan? Is that, no? Okay.
No, just Ben Kenobi's name on tattoo.
Oh, okay.
Old Ben. I just watched the movie with my son this morning, so like I've got micro knowledge of what's going on.
All right. Okay, and one more thing I just wanted to, well, I guess I kind of touched it already. I personally think Hermione is the best leader in the entire series. I'd be interested to see what you guys think about that. Do you have a leader in mind? Do you have a character in mind that you think is the best?
I think the Weasley brothers are interesting. That start the store and all that. They've got a lot of influence in their area ultimately. You know, a lot of important stuff going on. So their store is not important, but it does seem like they're growing influence in commerce in a lot of ways.
They are. And they actually demonstrate self-leadership because they quit school. They went out and they started their own. Well, they bought over the old joke shop, but they made it their own and they improved it and they became successful wizard men, I guess. So Severus is he's a very interesting it's hard to call him the best leader for me because he was very abusive to Harry and he didn't need to do that. You know, I mean, like if you look at the early books, he was protecting him, yeah, but maybe he could protect him without, you know, being super mean. So it might have been an act to, you know, make all the other people believe that he hated him, but I don't know. He could have reduced some of the intensity, I think. But I know there's a lot of Severus Snape fans out there. And yeah, great point, Mike, about Dumbledore. He knew everything and he still allowed, you know, stuff to happen. Because I mean, half the time he basically put people in situations and he was very manipulative. Yeah, that's a good point. Although in the book, I've kind of talked about it more positively than, you know, recent events have sort of unraveled, I guess. And a great point about Neville. Neville is, to me, the person that has grown the most. Like normally you have, you know, ebbs and falls, but Neville, it's pretty much been a upward trajectory, especially from book 5 onward. I mean, by the time you come to book 7, Neville is probably the leader of the students at Hogwarts. I mean, he's the guy who is, I mean, in the end, he's the guy who kills Nagini, you know, so that's like, that demonstrates that. Okay, let me get to the next. Oh, is there a question? No. All right, so these are some of the concepts I've covered in the book. So I talked about personality, and I also have a chapter on intelligence, cognitive and emotional. Both forms of intelligence are super important, but of course, you know, the best combination is obviously you need to have them both. Which I think Hermione, for me, that's why I picked her, because she is probably the smartest in the whole school. And she's also the most emotionally intelligent person. Like throughout, she's always calm and steady. I mean, she loses her temper once in a while, but that's okay. Harry, on the other hand, his emotional intelligence was pretty bad in book 5. I mean, half the time he's just, and it didn't help that Umbridge is introduced in that particular book, which just makes it a lot worse. Then I also talk about authentic leadership, ethical leadership, self and shared leadership, and there's more. So essentially, if you look at the book, it's got a wide area of topics that are traditionally studied and learned about in leadership. But I have basically used the Harry Potter context to make it simpler, to make it understandable. So I actually took a sneak peek at Sai and Gordon's slides, so I kind of got inspired by them, I guess, a bit. So I thought I'd talk a little bit about where the book can fit in. Classroom settings, obviously, undergrad and graduate courses. I would ideally think that this would work better as a discussion-oriented class, something where you can really get into the meat of the matter, you know, like, take this book, read all the Harry Potter books along with it, and have a semester of fun. I'm trying to convince people in my university to do that, but you know, I don't know if that'll happen or not. I might need some help. So those of you that are potions experts, you know, get in touch with me later on. We'll discuss it. Practitioner settings, I think the book can be used for executive training. It's like all our books can be used for that because they all explain leadership and they explain them in ways that people can understand. And, you know, you can read the book for fun around a bonfire, hopefully not in the bonfire. Like, you know, off late, a lot of these random dudes who have never read Harry Potter, they arranged for that book burning, and I just don't understand that. But anyway, hopefully my book won't join the, you know, throng of bonfire bits. Pretty much all I had. It's right there. I put my LinkedIn profile, but it didn't come out very well. So if you just search for my name on LinkedIn, you can find me. Or I can put it in the chat, actually. My email address is... Yeah, so get in touch with me. If you want to collaborate on anything, or if you just want to talk about something, I'll be delighted to. So... thanks again for the opportunity to talk about my book in this webinar. So I'll mute myself now.
All right, thank you very much, Addy. Let's open up the floor to questions. So any questions? I know Brian had asked a great question about why we hadn't really talked about transformational leadership so much. And I know Mike, you'd mentioned that in the Star Wars and Lord of the Rings book, that there's some transformational leadership. So who would you say is the most transformational leader in Star Wars?
Well, in Star Wars, I'm gonna have to go. There's a lot of examples of transformational leadership in Star Wars, because with transformational leadership, you know, one of the four big eyes of transformational leadership is about developing others. And so I think inherently, whenever you look even at that mentor-mentee relationship that's so characteristic of the master and the Padawan, pretty much you're seeing transformational leadership occur, at least that particular eye of transformational leadership. I mean, if you put it all together, I would say probably Obi-Wan Kenobi was a big one. Maybe the fact he's on my mind since the show's coming out later in the month. Again, a little bit sketchy in terms of some of the things he might have said in terms of how truthful they were. But if you think about it, he does get followers to think outside the box. And so that's a big thing that he does. He does provide a vision. You know, we got to save the princess. We got to go figure out what's going on with Leia. But even before that, in the prequels, we have to get to the heart of what's going on with these trade disputes. We have to figure out what's going on with the separatists versus, the warring factions in the Clone Wars. And so he's in some ways a transformational leader because he gets people to see beyond themselves. I also think Rey is a transformational leader. I know that's maybe an unpopular opinion since the sequel trilogy has been not really perceived very well. Sai, Gordon, Addy, and I were in another session a couple weeks ago where I was defending the sequel trilogy. But I think she's very much a transformational leader because she gets people to see beyond their own self-interest to work towards a greater common good, perhaps. And in doing so, she, you know, Luke's grumpy at this point, and she turns him around. You know, she says, hey, you know, why are you so grumpy, in essence, without saying this? But she presents him with a vision. She presents him with an ideal. It gets him to think in a different mindset. To me, that's what a transformational leader is all about. Gordon. Go ahead.
Oh, no, I was going to say somebody wrote, Addy wrote that Luna Lovegood is a transformational leader, which is not who I would immediately guess. So why Luna?
Oh, no. I wasn't saying Luna was transformational.
Flitted away
when
like
I was talking
Luna.
About transformational, I just kind of flitted away to talk about the other topics. So I'll respond to this in the chat. So.
Okay, great. And Gordon, did you have a transformational leader in mind for Marvel?
I think Captain America is probably a good example of sort of a vision, of what the team should do and how things should proceed. I think T'Challa the Black Panther certainly would fall under this category as well, of trying to set something up while that idealized influence and giving people ability to have their own input into what's going on. So that's what I would say probably in the Marvel universe, what I see the most overall.
Okay, so that's a pretty good choice. I think, Mike, did you want to add one thing?
No, I was actually going to ask you and Gordon what you thought from the MCU. So, yeah.
Oh, okay. All right, so we've got a question for Salva. I apologize if I'm not pronouncing that correctly. In regards to transformational leadership, do you believe that the universe / workplace, equality improves when women mentor men in these instances? So I'm going to go off something Gordon said earlier, and I will say that female leaders across most of these franchises seem to be better, which actually reflects probably reality. So Leia is a very, very good leader. By the sequel trilogy, even before the sequel trilogy, I think she shows a lot of good leadership skills. Mike, you can let me know if I'm wrong about that. Gordon, about Black Widow, absolutely very, very good female leader, and along with the examples of being from Black Panther, and Addy, Hermione, I think also a great leader in this case, right?
Even Minerva McGonagall, she was a amazing mentor.
Good. And I don't know, in terms of mentoring male, female to male, I might say this isn't really a mentorship relationship, but Black Widow is actually able to help the Incredible Hulk quite a bit in the movies. Even though their relationship weirdly went into some romantic territory, I do think that she was able to kind of support him and guide him in a way that you don't see from some of the other male, from some of the other male characters. Gordon, is there anything else, anybody else that you can think of that's like a woman?
I think the question of mentorship, there is some research to suggest that some of the relational aspects, women leaders can be better at those areas. But certainly you do have some of those issues of, and we talk about in our chapter, female leaders being put in more precarious situations or not given as much power. And in those situations, I think that can be something that makes it more difficult to be mentors or to be able to help in that way. So if they're disconnected from the basis of power, that can be very unhelpful in a mentorship type relationship. And we do see that as well as women and minorities and organizations as well, is they can also be bombarded by mentorship requests. So every woman or every other Black person that joins the organization says, that one person in management who's Black, that's gonna be my mentor. And while that person may really wanna help and they might even be good at it, it's the amount, the degree, the fact that they have to deal with, not only racism against them, but racism that their mentees experience or sexism. And so I think it can help. It's not a solution enough of, well, we hired one upper level female leader. She'll make sure that if anybody is sexist to anyone at a lower level, they'll be fine, because then we're just making her into the pincushion for all the issues. And that's what we see sometimes with tokenism in organizations, and some of that as well is the tokens has to be in charge of every time there's an issue. And it's very emotionally taxing. It's very stressful. And they often don't have the influence that they wish they had. They can't fix the problem, but they always have the problem brought to them. So I think that's where it gets more complex to my mind on it.
Any of you wanted to add something?
I wanted to add, so I'm actually going to be answering from your MCU perspective. I think the ancient one, she was a great mentor for Dr. Strange. So, her, he would have probably been a pretty terrible, wizard, like Sorcerer Supreme. So she did her.
This is why we talk about Dr. Strange, Gordon, right here. First mentorship. Okay. So one, since we're talking about Rosalba, since you asked this question about women mentoring men, I will say that my master's thesis advisor, Dr. Diane Wentworth, who was here earlier, she's been a great mentor to me. So I'm the product of, and in fact, my dissertation advisor also is a woman, Dr. Chen Gonder. So I've been the recipient of very good mentorship from women. So big fan. Right. Any other questions? All right. So it looks like we're all out of questions. But I want to thank everybody for being here. I know this is it's late. We've all been on too many Zooms in our lives. But this has been an awesome conversation. Thank you for being a great audience. And if you are watching this at home on YouTube, please feel free to reach out to us. Please. Check out the book when you can. You can find it at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, any place at all. If you have a friend and you think they'd be interested in IO psychology, in leadership, and you want to get them into it, this is a good bridge that will help you build that relationship between IO psychology and everything else. So a link to Amazon, I will give you the link in the chat, at least for the MCU book, it's a tiny URL. .com/AmazonMCU, and you can always look it up using exploring effective leadership practices through popular culture. You will get there from the link that I provided. So for those of you watching at home, YouTube, it is tinyurl.com/AmazonMCU, all lowercase. And thank you everybody for being here, and Addy, thanks for actually giving a real link to Amazon. That's great.
Yeah, I'm not sure what link Addy put in versus mine. I think the one that I put in is for the book series. So for some reason, the MCU book one is not listed there just yet. I don't know why. It has, it has Star Wars and Lord of the Rings and Harry Potter, but not the MCU one there as well. For some reason, I don't know why that is.
Okay. We'll get on that. But thank you, everybody, for being a wonderful audience. Sarah, if you'd like, I will stop recording.
Yeah, she might have left as well.
Oh, she might have left. All right, so I'll make an executive decision showing good adaptive leadership, and I will bid everyone adieu and stop the recording.
Thank you to Sai for moderating so well.
Thanks, Sai.
He tends to take that role here and then takes no credit for it. So thank you, Sai.
Thank you very much, Gordon. I appreciate it. This is why this is a good partnership. You're giving me credit. Thank you very much, everybody. Okay. Have a good night.
See you.
Bye.